Good evening, everyone. Welcome to A World Awakening. You know, I've done a lot of shows. I've done gobs of interviews over the years. I don't think I've ever been more excited to bring someone into the fold the way I am tonight. We have a very, very special guest. She is the new mistress of the farmhouse, mistress of the house. The next owner, the new owner, I told her the day that I met her that I knew this was meant to be. And I knew that she would, in so doing, purchasing the farm, would actually be starting a whole new chapter in her life and living into her own destiny. I absolutely believe this. And the reason that I do is because I've had the privilege and the pleasure of getting to know her over the last few months. And we chat frequently, and we have developed a true kindred spirit vibe that I treasure. And so without further ado, I would like to welcome Ms. Jacqueline Nunez to A World Awakening. Hi.
Hi there. Hi, Andrea. Thank you so much for having me on your show. It's quite a privilege. It's quite a privilege to be here, and it is certainly a privilege that I now get the honor of being in your life. So,
sweet. See, you know, if you keep talking like that, you're going to be stuck with me forever. You wouldn't be able to peel me off of your shoe any more than you could take off bubble gum that had been sitting in 120 degrees.
And I'm totally fine with that. You know, when I when I got through, I think about halfway, and of course I have read all of your fabulous books. Oh. And when I got through, I don't know, maybe the first half of the first book, I just felt such a connection to you and to your family. I mean, it just, you guys felt like family. It was really kind of bizarre. So I couldn't wait to meet you. And I was nervous, actually, the first time I met you. But you were everything that I imagined. And so I am thrilled. So thank you.
Thank you. And, you know, we have a number of things in common here. Let me do that, because the fan, you know. Oh. We have a number of things in common. I believe on our first meeting, I told you that I have the world's most perfect dog, the Princess Peanut Buttercup, that she is the best dog on the whole planet Earth, the best one. And you said, I think there's been some error, because I have the best dog and her name is Princess Dottie. And do you happen to have Princess Dottie with you?
She is lying right beside me.
Oh, that's wonderful, because you see, my perfect dog is lying right beside me as well.
And I also have two perfect cats.
You do, and I do not. So you're two up on me there. You're two up on me.
So they might be, knowing them, they will be like jumping into
yeah, there's the one on your shoulder right now. Yeah, actually.
Okay, there he is.
Yeah.
Okay.
There you go.
There
you go.
So now, all of my pets are gray, so I am now referring to them as the resident grays.
Well, that's wonderful. That's just perfect, you know, because I'm absolutely, I don't know about dogs. They seem pretty grounded. But hello, darling. Oh, look who it is. It's one of our regulars. Thank you. Thank you, sweetheart. She wrote, wishing you all the best with the house. So happy that it found someone who's going to respect and take good care of it. And that is absolutely true. Amen. That, you know, I mean, you are my dream come true. If I had to sit at, thank you, Neil. He's one of my relatives. He is, because all parents are related. All parents are related. We all come from one town in France.
Really?
Yeah. And then migrated to Canada and then down into New England. And then we dispersed beyond. But we're all related with that spelling, where somehow we have the same blood coursing through our veins. You know, when I met you, I was so taken with you, not just taken with your intellect and your capacity to, you know, understand the gravity of this move, and what it would mean, you know, to be able to extrapolate it out and see what this encompasses, because I, you know, I feel like the farm is iconic. It is, you know, for me, it's like the pyramids, it's like Stonehenge, it's like, you know, the Acropolis. It's just, you know, like a, that kind of an important spot on Earth. And I knew the instant that I met you, that you were the one, you were the one. And I said it to you in the lobby of a hotel. And that was really just the beginning. And I've truly, you know, you say it's your privilege, but no, really it's mine. Because I know that great and wonderful things will come from this. And I've shared my most heartfelt desire in the paraphrased words of Madame Curie, which is at the opening of my show. Now is the time to learn more, to know more, so that we may fear less. And, you know, I've always felt that everything that swirls around the farm is about intention. I use that word frequently, probably ad nauseum. But this interview tonight, well, this, it's not an interview. It's just one more discussion. It's just, there's a lots of eavesdroppers. But this, we don't even know how many. We can only count them on a few platforms. This pertains to the meaning of the show, A World Awakening, because I believe that you are part of that awakening. And I told you right away, this is you just living into your destiny, just let it unfold. It's absolute perfection. And I know that you feel that too, in spite of any trepidation that you might have had. I hope that that has just dissipated into the ether and that you are completely and utterly comfortable in that house, because I have been with you in that house and I know that the house loves you. And I think that's so beautiful.
Well, I certainly hope that you are right. And I certainly hope that that the spirits certainly accept me. And as you know, I just kind of want to touch on you talking about stepping into my destiny. You know, I have a wonderful spiritual advisor who has been in my life for all of my adult life. And so when I first started, when I first saw the farm and put it under agreement, of course, I started having many conversations with him. And that was exactly what he described to me, that that I'm basically stepping into my destiny. And I feel like I've been kind of preparing for this probably most of my life. If I look back on my own spiritual journey and what I've learned, and I was also, because I put it under agreement in September, we are now in Maine in May. So there have been many months, right, preparation. I also feel like that things started happening in my life when I put it under agreement to force me to really basically look at certain aspects of myself and make sure that I cleaned up certain aspects of myself and took care of myself in certain ways so that I would be ready for this. And actually something very scary happened to me at the end of October. I almost died. I had an event that I ended up, I was on a weekend away with my dog, with my perfect dog, Dottie. And we were hiking in the Hudson Valley and I was staying in Kingston, New York for the night. And I had gone to a restaurant and I walked out. And the last thing I remember is collapsing. And I wake up in a hospital and I can't talk. And they're getting ready to intubate me. I wasn't breathing. I had walking acute pneumonia. And so I was intubated for about 15 hours. I was in ICU. And I ended up being in the hospital for 4 or 5 days. And they told me if someone hadn't called, like, you would be dead, Jacqueline. And so that was very much a turning point for me. And it really made me look at my life and the stress that I was under, you know, at the time, and just what I needed to do to be ready for this. So, So I think that happened to me, you know, all things happen for a reason. I think it happened to me to, like, push me towards making certain decisions in my life so that I would be ready for the moment that I'm in now.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Life does have a tendency to throw wake up calls our way.
It does.
And, yes. You know, in October of 2019, I almost died from COVID, but nobody knew what it was yet, had not been identified.
Wow.
I was within hours of my vital organs all shutting down, falling like dominoes. That was a pretty scary wake up call for me too. And then I took a considerable amount of time to heal and to get myself on the right track and learned not to overbook, not to overcommit, not to, you know, put myself out there to the extent that it became at my own expense. And you will find that path as well. And, you know, I'm right there with you. I'm right there with you. If you ever need anything, I got you on speed dial right here.
Well, thank you. I mean, I definitely feel, just for all of you wonderful people listening, and thank you for being here. My profession for the last 18 years has been, I am a real estate developer in the Boston area. I've been building high-end condominiums for the last 18 years. I own my own company, and, you know, I've been hiring my own crews and dealing with banks and dealing with, you know, so it's been very stressful. And I think it was Serena, Andrea, when they were here filming, when I got to meet her, she made a comment about, and she was talking about herself and her own life, and she said something to the effect, you know, when things start to get really difficult and you're banging your head against the wall and you just can't make progress, that is usually a sign that it's time for you to go in a different direction. And I'm like, huh, that's so true, because I've been struggling a lot for the last few years in my real estate development, and I just couldn't figure it out. Like, why had it become so difficult? Why had it become so stressful? Why had it become so this, or why had it become so that? And I think it was the universe saying, because you need to stop doing it. You need to transition into something else. And here it is, right? Yes. And I've been preparing for it for so long. I've been looking at land. You know, I've been dreaming of owning land somewhere out in the country for probably at least 10 years. And I look at real estate all the time. So, and finding the farm, it checked off a lot of boxes for me, even outside of the whole activity and stuff, and the spiritual aspects, just the physical land itself and the property is just gorgeous, just even without that.
Yes, it is. It holds a very special energy that is unlike any place I've ever been in my life. I've lived in a lot of places. I've traveled a great deal. I've been to many historically haunted locations on my journey in the paranormal world when I stepped in about a dozen years ago. And I've never felt anything like the farm, not anything. It's just absolutely special and unique. And for me, it's sacred ground. For me, it speaks to something so deep in my soul that, as I've told you, it's literally the only place that has ever felt like home to me in my whole life. Which is interesting because I think of it as an interdimensional portal more than it is a structure, even though it is, you know, a true, authentic colonial home. And I also think it's interesting that what it taught me about me is that I'm more comfortable living in 4D in the spirit realm, 5D in the ET realm and beyond than I am in this 3D realm that I find so incredibly oppressive and dense and heavy. And so when I'm there, it's something else entirely. I feel transformed while I'm there. I'm my best self when I'm there. And that is a real blessing to me. And another blessing too, is that I get to introduce you and have had the pleasure already of introducing you to some of my closest friends, my nearest and dearest. I introduced you to Julie Griffin, Ken DeCosta, and Cody DesBiens and Satori Hawes. Actually, I think Jennifer introduced you to them before I did, but I reintroduced them. It has been, it's been such a delight. It's been such a pleasure. But before we bring them on, and those, you know, they're coming in to join us tonight for this rambunctious conversation. Papa is here too. However, before we do that, I also introduced you to one of my friends, RJ Heim, who is a reporter for NBC 10 out of Providence. And he did a beautiful piece. I was so thrilled when I saw it. And I asked our producer here, Bill, and Bill, you can, just get that ramped up. But I want to share this with everyone because I think it's phenomenal. He did a wonderful job on this piece. You looked fantastic. You look really great in purple, by the way. I just thought I would mention that. So do I. So, you
thanks.
Know, again.
Thank you, because I need to find a color. I need to find my color.
Okay, well, you can have my color. I'll share it with you. It's fine. But anyway, yes, Bill, if you would be so kind, sweetheart. He's the man behind the curtain. He will run that piece so that everyone can see it. And then I want to bring Dad in to talk to you for a few minutes, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
That Harrisville, Rhode Island house made famous in the movie The Conjuring has been sold again, just 3 years after the last time, but for four times as much. The Night Team's RJ Heim conjures up the first television interview with the new owner only on 10.
Boston developer Jacqueline Nunez was drawn in when she saw the listing for this house in Harrisville, known for what some former residents and current investigators say is paranormal activity.
As a kid growing up, my family, we loved horror movies. We just watched them all the time. So of course, you know, I loved The Conjuring movie. I'm also a deeply spiritual person. This house provides an opportunity for us to communicate with people that have passed.
Ed and Lorraine Warren's investigation into what was happening in this house was the basis for the 2013 movie. Andrea Perrin wrote a trilogy of books she says tells the decades-long tale of her family's experiences living there for a decade.
It's magical. It's a portal cleverly disguised as a farmhouse. It's multiple dimensions interacting simultaneously.
For the past 3 years, Corey Heinzen, who bought the house for just over $400,000, has been renting it out nightly to those who want to see, hear, and feel for themselves.
Doors opening and closing on their own, footsteps, knocking, the disembodied voices. Last night we had a black mist in one of the rooms. It looks like smoke. It'll gather in one area and then it'll move.
I'm sure that there will be things that startle me.
After crunching the numbers, Nunez says buying the estate for $1.5 million is doable.
I want to be as historically accurate as I can. There will be no faking anything here. I'll be spending 2022 learning the business and then planning how to expand the business to afford more paranormal engagement.
One of the conditions of the sale, interesting to note, is that the new owners don't live in the house full time.
Make sure that we take protections, that we are not inundated and overwhelmed with the energy here, whether good or bad.
Nunez lost a brother a few years back and says through a medium has made contact and believes there's more beyond our current human experience.
I believe in reincarnation and that we come back and that we have things to learn in any given lifetime. I've never looked at this in a scary kind of way, is certainly a great opportunity to explore and learn from the activity and energy that's going on here.
RJ Heim, NBC 10 News 19.
Wow.
I'm Roger. Yes.
Hello, my dear. How are you?
I'm good. How are you? What a pleasure to see you tonight.
Yeah, it's more of a pleasure of me to see you. You're beautiful. Beautiful.
Thank you. When are we getting you up here to Rhode Island?
Whenever you say.
I know. I know. I hope you come in here in a couple of weeks with Andrea when she's coming on site to film.
Oh, I definitely will be there, without a doubt. But I found out something this afternoon that you've been all over the world in the past day or so.
I don't know if I've been all over the world, but
yes,
there have
you been. Have. Yes, you
there have been a couple of. You know, I'm waiting for these 15 minutes to be over.
Well, from what I hear, you've been on MSN, which is an international news network on
Yahoo.
The internet.
Yahoo News.
Okay.
Yahoo News. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. You are getting to be quite famous, young lady.
Well, I mean, I think pretty similar thing happened when the Heinzens bought it and then when they put it up for sale. I mean, people love this house. People are very intrigued by the activity here. Of course, all spearheaded by the experiences that you and your family had here for your 10 years being here. I mean, that you are why the world knows about this house and this farm.
Yeah, from what I understand, we're pretty much the last of all the Mohegans that lived there for any length of time like we did. And we did experience quite a few things, that's for sure.
Yeah. How do you look back on your experiences here?
If I had to do it all over again?
Yeah, would you do it?
Absolutely, positively, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, because everything that happened to us, it took me a while to understand exactly what was going on in the house. But once I did get connected with, especially Mrs. John Arnold, I knew that was the place for us.
Mm-hmm.
And the family did enjoy living there very much so. We enjoyed the spirits. We enjoyed the animals. We had every kind of animal we could think of in those days. And I really enjoyed feeding them and taking care of them and working with the kids and the horses and so forth.
I love your bull story, the bull that you had.
The what story?
Didn't you have a bull?
A bull.
Hey,
yeah.
Boy. Hey, yeah. Boy.
Hey, oh, boy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He was quite the guy. And he was like a pet dog to me because he wouldn't even eat by himself. I had to be there and sit next to him in order for him to eat. He would look at me and then eat. But if I got up to walk away, he'd stop eating. That was it. It was an incredible animal. And I really hated to get rid of him, but it reached that point that particular time. So we found a home for him with a young girl. She was 11 years old, and she was
nice.
Working with some organization, young persons, farmers, type
4-H.
Of thing. It was 4-H, but something for the young ones.
Mm-hmm.
And when she saw him walk out of the truck, that was it. That was it. That was her animal. And I'm sure he went to her as well as he went to me. He used to love to wrestle with me against my shoulder here and against his head, and that was a lot of fun too.
Oh yeah, and you know, let's not romanticize this too much because I have 3 broken toes because of that bull who crushed steel-toed boots into my feet.
Oh, well.
Yeah, because he was like, I don't know, 3,000 pounds. I mean, he was huge. And he stomped all over my feet and he crushed my boots. And my father had to have tools to cut the leather away and pry as I'm like writhing in pain.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I have broken. I do not have pretty toes because of Hey Boy. So, you know, not for nothing. But it's not all, you know, pixie dust and flowers.
Don't you remember the day he tried to hug me?
Yeah, he tried to hug
you. With his two paws around my shoulder. Oh, my God.
Yeah, he took him right to the ground.
Unbelievable.
Yep, right to the ground.
Unbelievable. He just wanted to hug and kiss me.
Oh, I mean, speaking of which.
What?
The world's most perfect dog is here.
Oh.
Look at this baby. Hi, baby. Your baby. So give me a sweet kiss.
Hi, baby.
Peanut makes an appearance on every single episode of World Awakening.
Yeah.
Even if I have to wake her to do it.
Yeah.
You're my baby. Okay, go back to sleep. Oh, okay. Well, we're going to bring on our other guests and get cooking with gas here. And yes, absolutely, Ms. Jacqueline, he's coming with me.
That's great.
Yeah.
Well, my dear, I'm just going to say one thing. Welcome to the paranormal family.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm thrilled to be here.
There you go.
You are a part of the clan now. You are.
There are paranormals and there are paranormals. We'll talk to you later, hon.
Okay, bye, Roger.
Take care.
Thanks, Dad. Now, can you get me some ginger ale? And can you finish this? There we go. No, finish it. Just do it. It's in the witch glass. You'll love it. It's extra special. Okay, so that said, you know, and my father is very fond of you. I'm so pleased that you've had a chance. You haven't met him in person yet. We've, you know, done a few right. Zoom sessions, but, you know, he's as thrilled as I am. He's as thrilled as my mother is and all of my sisters. I mean,
Yeah, I can't wait to meet the rest of your family, your mom and your sisters. I can't wait for that.
Yes.
And I appreciate how warmly you and your dad have just brought me in. That has meant the world to me that you guys have done that.
Well, you are sincerely embraced, and it is your it's your everything. You know, I've talked to you about this. It's not just your stellar intellect, it's your heart, it's your soul, it's your light, it's your, you know, everything about you just screams, oh, you know, it's like bingo, you know, that's the one, she's the one, there it is, this is done, this is set in stone, it's so great. And I did have the pleasure, I think, am I the one who introduced you to Ken DeCosta?
Yes.
I am, okay, so yes. I get the gold star.
Yes.
Bill, if you would be so kind to bring Mr. DeCosta in, I will let him, you know, speak his piece about you falling like a perfect puzzle piece into this epic saga.
Hi, Ken.
Hi, Jacqueline. Nice to see you again. How are you? And Andrea, thank you for inviting us tonight. It's a pleasure to be here. You know, Jacqueline, the first thing and the only thing really that came to mind when I knew I was coming on was to just tell you this. I've had the pleasure of being welcomed into a lot of historic locations in the years that I've done this and spoken to a lot of the owners of these places. And when you're an owner of an historic place, you know, you have everything that comes with it. You know, there's the maintenance and the bills to pay. But when you become an owner of an iconic, famous, historical location, I think you cross that boundary from owner to stewardship.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lineage here now. And you are the next in line, you know, whether it's the Arnolds, the Perrins, the Heinzens, mm-hmm. anybody. Own the house, here you are now. And personally, I couldn't be more pleased that this house found you, or vice versa, depending on how you look at that. Mm-hmm. But this is part of the lineage now. And for all intents and purposes, you are the gatekeeper in this new era. And leaving it, and I hope you have many, many years of success and above all, happiness there. Because I think it's always been that kind of location that brings people. There's a curiosity to it, but there's also a joy in being there as well, especially when you're surrounded by like-minded people with the right intention. So I couldn't be happier from my own personal perspective. I just wish you all the best in the world. And like all of those who've come before you, you know, I wish you many years, but you know, years from now when that time comes, you leave the place to whomever that's going to be in better shape than you found it. And that's how a lineage continues. So congratulations to you. We're all very happy.
Thank you. And I appreciate your characterization of my ownership as a stewardship, because that really is how I look at this. I do feel very privileged, honored, and lucky even that I that this farm and its legacy is now in under my guidance and in my hands. And even though I do feel it's part of my destiny, I still have a deep appreciation for the events that have enabled this to happen. So I take it to heart, and I take it very seriously. And I do feel like I am a steward of the place. Now, I am brand new, even though I'm a very spiritual person and I've always had an interest in the paranormal, I am very new to your community. And I have so much to learn, right? And I'm sure I'm gonna make mistakes. And, but I really do look forward to, you know, seeking advice and guidance from those of you that have been in this for a long time, and just whether it's just logistics about things, just as an example, right? I do have a lot to learn, so I will be relying upon many of you to kind of help me along, you know, as I kind of figure out the business model, figure out what to do, what types of activities to support, maybe what not to do. You know, so much of this is also what not to do. And so I need to get that balance right of what to do and what not to do.
Yeah. If that makes sense. That, we're all happy to share past experiences, those of us who have done or embarked, you know, have done what you're embarking on right now. But I mean, in the end, we're all still seekers. You know, we're all still learning as we go along, because there's so many doors to open. But, you know, as we chatted briefly at the house during the film, you know, rest assured, I speak for a lot of us within our organization and outside of our organization. You know, Jacqueline, we are there for you. We are there through, you know, the good times, bad times, whatever it may be, but we avail ourselves to you. So all you need to do is ask. And
thank you.
That's the truth. Hi, Annie.
Hi, Ken. Well, you know, one of the reasons that I was so happy to introduce you to Jacqueline is because you learn as you get older that there's, you know, not a lot of people that you can implicitly trust. That late night phone call that you might have to make, or just reaching out for a friend, you know, that level of trust and inclusion. I think we all feel very protective of you, Jacqueline. I think that in a way we're kind of circling the wagons and
I'm sorry if
boogeymen out.
I'm sorry if that comes through, but you're right. You know, we are, you know.
That's wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah, you know.
He's the most trustworthy person I know in this field, you know, and not only in terms of his background, his He's a walking encyclopedia of knowledge on the paranormal. None of us are experts. Mm-hmm. We all know that. We openly admit it. But there are very few people who know more about this field and who have done more research than Ken. So he's your go-to guy on so many different levels. It's ridiculous. I'm the one whose shoulder you cry on. I'm really good for that, patting you on the back. It'll be okay, honey. It'll be all right. He's like, yeah, what do you need answered? What do you need vetted? What do you need? What do you need? And he's got it.
You know, and I think, and that you bring up a great point, you know, because part of my process and challenges, if you will, because this is a new industry for me, I don't know people, right? I mean, I've spent the last 18 years cultivating a team. You know, these guys on my construction crew, I've been working with most of them for 15 to 17 years. I mean, when I'm a very loyal person, and they've been very loyal to me, but now I'm in a whole new other arena, and I have to create a whole new team to build and have be part of all of this with me. So that's a huge piece of this. Getting the right people involved,
we all face that, Jacqueline, because we have a passion for something that's hard to quantify, you know, when we're dealing with the paranormal and things that are outside the realm of science, things that we haven't cataloged yet, because we do love our lists and to be able to put things in a certain order. So this is what I mean by, you know, we're all kind of going through this together. And the community, by and large, tends to embrace people who have, I don't know, the right heart, the right intentions. And I know it's something for me, in the brief time we had to chat, because there was a lot going on that day, I felt that immediately. So I echo Annie's sentiments. And I know Jen Heinzen is in chat today, and she seconds that herself. They knew right away that
yes,
you were the one. So, it's something I guess to be proud of, and you know, I was just so happy to welcome you.
Thank you, and I'm glad that you just brought up Jen and Corey first. I really appreciate their trust in me too. They had a lot of people to choose from, right? And I thank them profusely for
Jen
for passing off this incredible opportunity and this incredible legacy in history to me. And I want to acknowledge them here, because they have done an amazing job in the time that they have owned this and opening it up to the public and really allowing people to come in, because it, as we all know, that wasn't happening. And the business that they have started, that I'll be taking over, they've done a great job. They always like to tease that they're terrible business people, but it is just absolutely not true. I mean, I'm taking over their systems and they have so many great things in place. There are such great bones and structure here that they built for me to build upon, that, I mean, they deserve a lot of credit. They deserve a lot of praise, and I love them both a lot.
I absolutely second that. I have worked closely with them over the last 3 years, and, you know, I only vaguely knew them, like, hi, how are you at a paranormal conference that we happened to attend as I was walking through. But when I really got to know them, I knew how much they love the house. Mm-hmm. And Jennifer and I have just such a sweet sisterhood. Mm-hmm. Corey's too tall. I can't really reach up, and he's all hidden behind the beard, and I can't really, you know, get on in there. But Jen fits right inside my arms, and I'm so in love with their children. Yeah. I give her all the credit. No, but with their children, that I've frequently offered to just simply take them off her hands and adopt them. They're such, you know, you can tell an awful lot about people by the kids they raise, an awful lot. And when I first met Madison and Kyler, I was so taken with their maturity and their grace and their really focused way that they approached the farm and the happenings there. But they were also incredibly forthcoming about their emotions about regarding the experiences that they had there. They weren't guarded. They were just open-hearted.
Yeah.
And I see those same qualities in you as well. And I think you have to be that to coexist with the farm. I think that you have to have that kind of simpatico, that kind of intimate and essential longing and desire to be there. And they did the whole world a favor. And no one can deny that. They did the whole world a favor. They liberated that house. And they let people who wanted to love it as much as they do to enter that sacred space and to have their own experiences. And I will remain forever grateful to them.
Yes, and they did it in a very authentic way, without ego.
Yep, no pretense at all. None.
And you know, they're going to continue to be involved in the business. They're going to be helping me staff for the foreseeable future. They'll be coming and staffing for a week, a month. In fact, Corey will be back here on Monday to do the staffing for the following week. And that's how I'm going to staff it, like one week on for someone, 1 week off. And also Madison is going to be doing live stream events. Now she's so sweet and she's so smart. She has a huge following and she does a great job with her online streaming, her TikTok. I mean, she's hysterical. So I really look forward to keeping her involved and helping her grow her business, right? So so I really look forward and I'm thrilled that you're all going to remain involved.
Well, and the nice thing is too, you know, none of us are getting a day younger. And eventually, you know, we're going to need to pass the torch.
Yes.
And in some respects, that has already occurred. And on that note, I would very much like to welcome Cody DesBiens and Satori Hawes to our broadcast tonight, whom I adore, and they both know it. Also, two more kids that I would like to abduct / just adopt. You know, they're both A words, slightly different meaning.
But
so I'm going to give them a chance to speak because they too have had the pleasure of your company, and now I feel that they know you in heart as well, and they are both two of the kindest, sweetest, most intelligent human beings I've ever had the pleasure to stumble over, and I've known both of them since they were knee-high to a grasshopper. So it's I give them the floor to cordially welcome you to our paranormal family.
Well, thank you for inviting us to come on. Jacqueline, congratulations. It was a pleasure meeting you a few weeks back, and I think the house is such a magical place, and I'll let, you know, Satori speak in a moment, but, you know, without that house, you know, we've made, I guess you'd call it a family. We met people that we would have never met if it wasn't for the farm, and you're going to soon find that out, that relationships are going to be made there that would have never taken place anywhere else So that place is just magical. One of my favorite things to do is walk the property and walk over the bridge where the stream is and yeah. just absorb the energy that yeah. place has to yeah. give. You know?
Beautiful. Yeah. Oh my gosh, it sounds very muffled for some reason. Jacqueline, thank you so much for everything, for having the kind heart you do. I will admit that in the beginning, I was worried, okay, this house is going to new hands, because I was used to, you know, I am so appreciative of the Heinzens and what they have done for the house. And mm-hmm. so when they told us that somebody new is coming, and I was a little worried. And mm-hmm. when we had met you, I just felt your energy. And it was so, like, you had such positive intentions. And it was great to see that and to see somebody with that. And so I knew that Jen and Corey had picked a really good person for this house right away. You were awesome to hang around, and you were awesome to have dinner with, because that's the first day we met. It was a great experience. Hi to Madison and Jen and Corey and everybody. Again, that house, like Cody said, it just holds a lot of energy and a lot of memories. Truthfully, Cody and I, when we first started, you know, with our form of communication and kind of coming out to the public about what we do, that house was really the first place where we felt like it was a safe haven for us to do things like that. And it just brought so many people together. I mean, we just recently hung out with Jen and Corey and everybody, and we just gave them a book of our memories. And we were like, this house built so many memories here. And
so how did you meet the Heinzens? How did that whole relationship come about between all of you?
Well, we met them at two separate times, Satori and myself. I was aware of Corey years ago from a group that he was involved, a paranormal team he was involved with in Maine, a TAPS family team, actually. So I had known of Corey. We weren't, you know, close friends or anything. We were acquaintances. And once they purchased the home, it was really strange how things kind of fall into place. Like things are meant to happen for a reason. I'm definitely somebody who believes that everything happens for a reason. And I believe people cross paths that you're supposed to meet in life. And that's basically what happened. It was like a re-meeting of everybody coming together. And you know, we've been close friends for I want to say 3 or 4 years now, and mm-hmm. And you know, the farm became a second to us almost.
And the farmhouse, does some people give it such a more negative rap than what we have found with it? And this house has brought us together and has given us so many positive memories and so many things that, you know, we can't even begin to explain. So I'm just happy that a positive person has this house.
Thank you. I know that's one thing that's been kind of hard for me to reconcile a little bit. The negative, how people just want to focus on the negative perceptions of the activity. You know, as I have witnessed a lot on the YouTube videos and stuff of people that have done some investigations there. So I really look forward to helping change that perception about the house. So I really appreciate hearing you say that as you know, people that have done a lot of readings from the house, and you've communicated with a lot of spirits at the house. Mm-hmm. And I love your method. I mean, it's amazing. I was so impressed. I had never experienced any sort of reading like that before than with you guys, and that was just amazing.
Oh, well, thank you. And and yeah, you know, like you said, I definitely appreciate the fact that that you're heading in that direction, which is wonderful. Unfortunately, in this field, as you'll find out, fear sells, and you know, that's probably why you see a lot of videos that have that negative aspect as the primary focus. Because that's what people seem to grasp onto, unfortunately. But that mm-hmm. house has so much history that you don't need that. You just don't need that. If you tell the history the way it is and the way it happened, that's a beautiful story in itself. And that's what people should pay attention to, rather than the negative stories that have been perpetuated over the years.
In time, you're going to see it all, and you're going to learn to pick through some of the people that are there for more negative intentions.
Yes. And those are, and that's kind of a little bit of what I was alluding to earlier in terms of that everyone is new to me, right? People can contact me and I will have no idea who they are, right? So, that'll be a learning curve to me. I also hope and I want to believe, right, that as the perception of the energy, as we start to change it, right, that the activity actually can be very beautiful here, that is going to attract a whole different set of people that perhaps have stayed away from experiences here because it's has only focused on the negative. So I think it opens up a whole new market of people that will see the beauty of the energy here.
Yeah, to interject on that a little bit, Jacqueline, because, you know, it's something that, bothers me deeply. Because it's never actually ever, I think, going to totally dissipate as far as people's preconceived idea of the house. Basically because of the movie. And now a franchise. So there's always to be that attached, for better or worse. But I think that at the end of the day, whatever decisions that are made always have to be in the best interest of the house. Now, it might not make everybody happy. But I think if you put what is in the best interest of this location above everything else, I think things will take care of themselves. You know, and like I say, in this field, and I know we're going to have a longer conversation about this, we all are sometime down the road, but when you have a location like this, people tend to become emotionally invested in it because of the movies, because of what they've read, that Angela's books, or they're regulars to her show, whatever the case may be.
Yeah.
And a lot of times people have a sense of propriety to that. Their name is not on anything. They have, you know, they're not paying the bills, but famous places people tend to gravitate for or toward and have that sense of propriety. It's like, well, we hope that you're going to do this, or we wish that you would do that.
Yeah.
So a lot of times people come up with narratives to fit what they want to strongly believe that the place is. And certainly that's not everybody. There are some outstanding people who have come into that house. We can all vouch for that. But, you know, can't sort them all out. Sometimes, you know, it all comes down to, in my mind, I think we all agree, it's all about people's intention, like, what's your business here and what you want of this place?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Thank you.
Well, you know, it seems to me that there's not really that much difference between mortal souls and spirit. Based on my own experiences at the farmhouse, we had benevolent spirits, we had rather benign spirits, and then we had a couple that were, you know, particularly cranky. You know, I have my cranky days, and it's been my own observation that spirits do seem to retain many of their earthly qualities. And so somebody that was, you know, a miserable son of a bitch in life is probably going to be that way in afterlife, and vice versa. And I find that the immutable law of attraction seems to step in, you know. And Ken, I know you've written about this, you can speak to this as well. And, you know, Cody and Satori as well. You get back what you put out. And I did a number of documentaries, films, you know, a number of things over the last few years at the farm. And one in particular, I will not name names, but I will say that Before I brought these gentlemen into the farmhouse, I looked the lead guy right in the eye and I said, woe be unto you if you provoke in this house. Consider yourself forewarned. And they were good as gold while I was there with them. For all the hours that I was there with them, they were good as gold. And then I left. And they did their own thing. And whatever they did, and I don't think we saw all of it in the show, but whatever they did made them so sick they had to cancel their next shoot in their series. And, you know, I just figured they got what they deserved, you know, because I saw a little bit of the provocation. And frankly, and I only saw a little bit of it on the film that they kept, I can just imagine what happened in, you know, the wee hours of the morning when the Heinzens were asleep and trusting them to do the right thing. And what it actually turned into was something else entirely. And that's out there in the world forever now, forever. That can't be undone. And I really do think that there have been times that the spirits have just said, enough, enough, you know, too much, too many, too, you know, it's just too much. I remember the show that we did, Kindred Spirits, with Amy Bruni and Adam Berry, and of course, world famous Chip Coffee. And they didn't seem to get a whole lot of activity in the house. They picked up some things. They were absolutely, you know, like not your standard fare, but certainly, you know, nothing that was dark or foreboding. And, you know, I talked to Chip about it afterward and he said, well, you know, there's a reason for that. It was their intention. They came in with nothing but light and love. All of us did. We came into that house with nothing but light and love. And even though some of the experiences that they had might have been a little shocking at first, there was nothing threatening at all, at all. And that is because they're like Teflon. You know, it's all about this. And so I think that that's something that ultimately people should keep in mind and understand, that the law of attraction is immutable and universal and works at all times in every place and has no glitches in that system. So how they walk into that house and how they perceive that house and how it perceives them is the same. So it's going to be very interesting for you, I'm certain. If I were you, I would keep a journal of the experiences that you have every day. Just jot things down in a notebook. And then a year from now, go back and reflect on this journey that you're taking.
That's so funny, Andrea, because one of the mediums last night, when we were just sitting there talking before, there were three mediums on the Ghost Hunts team last night. And one of them looked at me and he said, you need to keep a journal. I'm being told that you're supposed to keep a journal. And then, and as you were talking about coming in with your intentions, that's also really funny that you said that, because you met Jennifer, right? Who's going to be helping me. I'm now referring to her as my bouncer because she's very protective. She's been in my life. We're dear friends since I think 2008. So she knows me really, really well. She's going to help me with operations, but she's also officially my bouncer. But anyway, she was talking to me about, because I meet the groups that come in, right? And so I really need to think about what I want to say to them. And she was suggesting to me that when I sit them down to talk to them about for them to think about the intentions that they have coming in here. And what they are hoping to get out of the experience and really make guests think about that. And so I thought that was very poignant that she suggested that to me today. And then you just said it. So,
yeah, I wanted to get, into a little something and bring Cody and Satori in on this, because, and this is kind of along those lines, a little off the beaten trail of the house, but just general topic. I think that what has happened because of social media, TV, paranormal shows, wonderful, but I think people are getting a little desensitized to the idea of spirits. And what I mean by that is that spirits are being used for props as almost like a background to, as a means to an end, whether it's on social media, whatever the case may be. And these were once people with hopes and dreams and, you know, successes and failures, and they lived a life just like we did, albeit maybe in different times. But they were parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and brothers. And we have to be very careful, because we're crossing a very fine line where we tend to, when I say we, it's just a blanket term, figure of speech, lift ourselves up at their expense. And this is what we talk about when we say intention and respect, where they are asked to perform for us. Mm-hmm. Cue, you know, lift this, move that, make that sound. I understand we're just trying to establish communication on some level. But a lot of times they're used, I can't think of a better word than prop for a lot of these things. So, you know, as a means to our own end, that, you know, whether it's fame, notoriety, whatever the case may be. And there is hardly a place on earth that's not guilty of that. You know, when people come in and when you start making it about you and a lot less about them, then I think that's when things go sideways. And I know Cody and Satori, I know my partners in crime here have something to say on that as well.
Yeah. Right?
Well, we can definitely agree that they are, I agree with what you're saying. When you kind of focus on more of the performance of it, it does quite affect them and how they view the situations. We have talked to a couple spirits in the house, and they definitely have their own ideas and attitudes depending on who you talk to. They're all different people. I can tell you there are a couple spirits that are very fond of having people come in the doors, and they're very, they're just very happy to be involved. They're happy to see difference in people. They will share their opinions sometimes if people are doing things like trying to provoke and be rude and act out. They will come to us and say, this person did that, or why was that person doing that? That made me feel uncomfortable. So it's interesting to kind of get their opinions, because it's almost like those people are being ratted out when they're trying to focus on themselves. And there is, we will say there is one spirit that we have communicated in the house that is very, she's just not a very happy person. And I think she plays into a lot of the fear. And the only reason that she sort of comes out is when people are kind of feeding that fear to her with that intention. So what you guys were talking about with intention is 100% the thing. If mm-hmm. you kind of go in with the intention of talking to her or whatever a negative thing is, you kind of do get her in that situation.
Absolutely.
But I agree with Ken, very much so.
Absolutely. Yes, I definitely think, and, you know, just like Andrea was speaking about earlier, that, you know, you get what you put out there. And I think just the human energy, living energy, has a huge, huge part in the experiences that happen as well. Because, you know, we found just because there isn't anything at the house currently, like the parents endured when you know, when it was their time in the house, we've, and Ken, you'll agree with me on this, we've done cases where houses, the whole energy changes as soon as new people move in. And sometimes it changes for the good, sometimes it changes for the bad. And I think we've noticed a shift over the years. And I saw Keith Johnson pop up And it, you know, it's amazing to think that next year will be 50 years since they first walked through the door of that home, and how much has changed in the history that has been built since they came in. 50 years is a long time for energy to change. And unfortunately, more people do pass away, and you have different property changes and things like that. So I think the house has definitely shifted over the years.
And Jacqueline's ideas for the house, you know, with more positive intention, kind of cracking down on that and making sure it's more positive use and spiritual and things of that nature, I think that's really going to help. And I think it's going to be a strange adjustment for them in that sense, because they're going to go from almost just seeing investigators to having a change, like, okay, there's more searching for this and more interaction with this kind of energy and what's going on. So it might be different for them, but I think they're going to like it when they start seeing how it's going.
When you set that down, and I can tell you this, and they can back me up, I've done a lot of these things in a lot of different locations over the years where we allow the public to come in. We currently do it. We've been at one particular location for 11 years. And we very rarely encounter anything like that. You know, we don't, because it's pretty much a given thing. Don't walk into Rise Up's place and do that.
Yeah.
Because Ken or somebody will probably throw you out a window.
Yeah, Ken's a good bouncer too.
But I think that you establish that, and if nothing else, by word of mouth. In plain English, it's just kind of like, we're going to this place and these people are there. Don't bullshit them.
Yeah.
And once that's established and that's passed on, then it eliminates a lot of those problems, you know.
So I want to tell you guys a really cool story that happened to my real estate broker from Coldwell Banker when she was at the house and they were taking photographs to prepare for the sale. She was talking to Jen and Madison, and they were just, you know, talking about the history of the families and stuff. And Bethany's father had passed maybe 4 or 5 years ago. And so Bethany goes home and she flips on her computer and Madison is doing a live event. And so Bethany tunes in, and her father comes through. I think Madison was doing the Estes method. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. And is that how you say it, Estes? Yeah. And Bethany's father came through to connect with her and talk and gave names and gave birth dates and gave like number of children and referenced what he did for a living, and it absolutely blew her away. And that is another right opportunity that people can have, coming in and inviting loved ones to come and talk to them there. I mean, I thought that was absolutely beautiful, and what a beautiful thing to happen. I just thought it was incredible.
Yeah, that place is magical.
Thrilled when you shared that with me earlier. And I shared something that happened when I was with you in the house. And Madison had no idea. Jennifer is saying she didn't even realize who the reference point was. You know,
right.
I mean, it's magical. And yeah. Like Cody and Satori, you know, they're doing a session at the farmhouse, and a spirit comes through with a name nobody recognizes. Nobody recognizes it from my books. It's the name Joseph. And so as they're looking at each other, like, should we know this name? Doesn't Joseph say, Nancy used to call me Manny, or Nancy called me Manny? I'm like, okay, it's been 50 years since we moved into that house. More than 50 years, and we're still learning about the spirits through an entirely different methodology that nobody even dreamed of. And Cody and Satori weren't even sparkles in their parents' eyes when we were living there, because their parents were children. And, you know, it's
you're just saying we're,
I know it's amazing, but I didn't tell Cody or Satori this. I wanted to share this with them on the show tonight. But when I was at the house a few weeks ago with Jacqueline and a film crew, one of the teams that I work with out of the UK, I had an experience, and Ken was there. And I won't divulge too much because I feel absolutely certain that the bulk of this is going to end up in the film that we shot. But I will say that Ken was talking in a very tranquil, very loving, inviting way with the spirits in the house. You know his voice. It's like all velvet and butter, and you know, it's just, and he's just talking to them with such kindness and reverence and respect. And it was so lovely, Ken. I never got to tell you that, but what you said, the words that you shared in that house, that shifted the energy. It did. And I just felt like something wonderful was about to happen. And I was sitting on the sofa and I closed my eyes and I said, she's behind me. She's behind me on the hearthstone and the fireplace in the parlor.
Right.
And then for a moment, Cody and Satori, I wish you had been there so that you could have witnessed this. For a moment, I could see everyone in that middle room through her eyes. And she was looking from the parlor into the what used to be our dining room. And all she could see was a room full of ghosts and apparitions. And she was standoffish. And so I told Ken, and he invited her into the room. I invited her into the room. We both told her that it was absolutely safe and that everyone there would be completely welcoming to her. And every gizmo and gadget in that room went off the charts. That's all that I will say for about 15 minutes.
Wow.
That's amazing.
That is amazing.
Off the charts. Like, I had never seen anything like it. And I could feel her. She literally came from that room and put herself right in front of me. I got that chill. You know, it wasn't awful, but I could feel the temperature change in the room. A number of people did.
Yeah.
And we had an experience that we captured on film that was absolutely beautiful.
That is amazing.
But part of it was, my dear Jacqueline, because you were there too. You know, there is a shift in the energy. And what you brought into that room, what Ken brought, and then everybody else that was involved in that particular shoot, we were all basically working with the same intention. And so it was like a kumbaya circle of love in that room that night. And she felt comfortable enough to step into it, even though she saw us as the ghosts. Well, and that is phenomenal.
It was the one time where, and I don't know who was responsible for it. I think I had said something with Serena or somebody, but where we were all in the room together, like the whole collective consciousness, everybody pulling on the same end of the rope. Because what happens invariably at a lot of these places is that everybody splits into groups and then buys and competes for the attention of the spirits there. Mm-hmm. If you put yourself in that position, I mean, how would you feel? You're just kind of like, well, I don't know who to go see here. Mm-hmm. But sometimes the groups can be a little large and it may be daunting and a little intimidating to have all of these people calling on you. But when everyone is in the same room and they're sharing that same groupthink, that same mindset and everything, the results of that can be amazing. You know, and I've seen it happen time and time again where everybody is just focused, you know, on everybody just concentrate on what you want the result to be. And there can be some amazing things that are happening rather than, you know, scattershot. Everybody, no, forget them. Come and see me. I'm in this with you. And it gets to be a little chaotic. But that particular night, I will say this, as far as gizmos going off, you know how I feel about gizmos. I'm kind of like this on. At that time, Cody and Satori, you know what I'm talking about. When we're talking about spikes and things, we're talking about an extended period of maybe 10 minutes where you get the kind of spikes if you were standing on the power line.
Yes, exactly.
It wasn't just a little beep, beep, bleep, buzz, buzz, light come on. This was like flattening the needle out and staying there for 10 minutes.
Wow.
At a place that we had swept previously and got absolutely nothing flatlined there. And just for that period of time, and as quickly as it came, it went. It was time to say goodbye, I guess.
Wow.
That's cool.
That's unbelievable.
That's cool.
Yeah. She just dispersed into the ether, and I didn't have a sense of her anymore. But in all the years that I've lived there, in the multitude of times that I have visited the house with Corey and Jen and all the filming that I've done there and everything that I've experienced there, I've never had anything like that happen to me before. And so you all knowing me as well as you do, you know I can't wait to get the back there and see what happens next. I just can't wait.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
All right. And so I have a question. Does the paranormal community, are there any formal training or guidelines put out by like you're a paranormal society or professional organization for how to train to become an investigator and any code of ethics? Or is there anything like that in that community?
It's too bad we don't have George here with us, huh, Ken? He could go off for a good 30 minutes about that.
We're going to get into the weeds on that at some point. I will tell you this, Jacqueline, it is possible to go online and take some courses where you can get a you can become a certified paranormal investigator, which frankly isn't worth the paper it's written on.
Exactly.
But there are no governing bodies or anything like that. It would be very difficult to enforce something like that because the paranormal isn't actionable.
Mm-hmm.
What I mean is that if there's a violation of anything, I mean, where do you go? Who governs this? The town clerk and a certain you I get know. A permit to do
you
it.
Watch a judge laugh you out of a courtroom, you know?
Right. And, you know, I mean, is there a complaint filed on you? But if anything in a legal sense is ever brought before a judge, it's like you better bring a ghost with you.
Well, I don't necessarily mean legal. Or is there any sort of code of ethics? Or what happens to investigators that are known to be fraudulent? Are they ostracized? Are they, like, what happens?
Yep.
Nothing?
Yeah, yep. It seems that the public kind of handles that to a point when people talk in this field. People really do talk in this field. And once you start to do something that is definitely, everybody starts realizing, okay, this is just for attention, or you're doing this just to try to get something big. The people will talk and the people will start telling other people around, like, this person has done this, just so you know. And so I guess in a sense, that's kind of them paying for what they've done. But to answer your question, I guess there isn't really a rule book or a manual for this. I think if there was and everybody followed this manual, for example, Cody and I wouldn't know that what we do is even a thing if we followed the rules. We had to break what was traditional investigating to figure out what this was. So I'm glad there aren't any rules. And honestly, I agree with Ken. There, like Jen said, there's no paranormal 101. But I guess if there are any rules, it's to just don't provoke. Go looking for answers, even if they aren't the answers you really want. If there is a logical answer to it, admit that logical answer. Don't just go off trying to play it off as something else, you know?
Right, yes. It seems like the field, at least in my opinion, is definitely built on reputation. At least in my opinion, the people that I entrust to work with, they have a good reputation in the field. And your years in the field definitely build up your reputation. And like Satori said, you know, people do talk, and the community is definitely an entangled one across the globe, literally across the globe. There's so many paranormal teams that you can't even keep count now, and everybody does it differently. And like I mentioned before, you're going to find this, you're going to have a lot of teams come into the home, and everybody's going to do it differently. Every single team does it differently, and they each have their own code of conducts. I mean, they each, you know, if a team is formed well, they each have their own code of conduct, but no team is pretty much alike when it comes to that, because every person is different, just like your friends group. Every person that you meet is different, that you come across, just like every team is different.
And sadly, Jacqueline, no matter what you do and no matter what route you take, some people are not going to be happy with a certain route, and some people are going to say, I know better and I can
do it. Yes.
And so you just do you, and you're doing it right.
Yeah, it's pretty much, it's pretty, when it comes to that, it's pretty much self-governance. You know,
it is self-governance, self-discipline, self-policing. And I'll tell you one thing, you want to know, you know, telephone, telegraph, tell a paranormal person that you know about somebody fraudulently falsifying evidence, they become persona non grata so fast in this field that they might as well just go dig a hole and crawl into it. You know, and there have been several people that, because apparently they were so hungry for some attention, falsified evidence, you know, faked events, that word got around so fast. You never saw them again at a paranormal conference. You never saw them invited onto any interviews anymore. Yeah. They destroyed their own reputation, and they're done. They're just done in the field. It's only happened a few times that I know about. Of course, I pretty much, I don't keep up with these things, because I have a tendency to kind of fly above the radar and look down and go, oh, that's interesting, I'm moving on. But, you know, those that are deeply ingrained in this field, if they catch someone doing something that is just immoral, unethical, it's spread like warm butter on hot toast all over the place. Everybody knows in a heartbeat what happened. And yes, I guess in a way, they are shunned, because can you associate with them? We live in a guilt by association world.
Yes.
And so you better know who you've allied yourself with. You better know who you can trust.
Yeah.
And you'd better know that there are some people that will do anything for their 15 minutes of fame and perceived fortune, attention, whatever that is. And I have already forewarned you of a few that I know about that are absolutely not to be trusted, that are in it for the white hot spotlight only, and seek only to forward their own career without any regard for the spirits they might be offending.
Yeah.
Just for the record, though, Annie, I have written a manual.
You have written a manual?
Yes. All our investigators get a manual.
Oh, well, that's great, Ken. And you're going to sign a copy and give one to Jacqueline,
it's probably lining bird cage. I don't know what they did. Cody, what did you do with yours? It's lining a bird cage.
No, I think it's holding up my file cabinet. It was off balance, I think.
Okay. They make excellent coasters.
Excellent coasters. You know, the one thing that I do want to talk about, though, with all of you, is your opinions. And I'll just state my own first. I don't think that people should try to cross spirits. I don't think that that's our role, that it's our, you know, it's certainly not our obligation. I feel like they're here for a reason. And they're, at least the way I feel about it is, you know, that we can open up some kind of communication on whatever level and learn from them. I think it's a blessing that spirit exists. And, you know, regardless of how, I see that face, Cody. You're thinking exactly. I can hear you thinking. I can hear you thinking. I just don't think that it's appropriate to attempt to cross a spirit. First of all, we don't know what we're doing. Second of all, they're here for a reason. Third, it doesn't give them the choice that they need to make one way or the other. And fourth, what if the house is so crossed there's nothing left to investigate there? That there's no one left to communicate because we literally scared them off or shunned them or forced them to leave. That is entirely counterproductive to the totality of the notion of paranormal investigation. So what do you all think about that?
I think Jacqueline should go first because she's the the new owner of the house.
Yes. Oh, sure. Shove it off on the new girl. Yeah.
Give me some extra minutes.
Yeah, so I...
10,000 feet, you know.
Putting you on the spot, but it was...
No, it's okay. I think that there's some nuance there. I think that, and I want to believe, that there are probably many spirits associated with the house that come and go. I mean, I don't know how many of them may or may not be trapped, but for me, and it wouldn't come from me, there are very talented mediums out there that specialize in like rescue work, if you will. And I've met a very talented one. I had to clear a house once of trapped souls that were truly suffering, and she released them. So for me, I think that there's a balance there. I wouldn't feel good to have a trapped spirit here who's suffering and to keep them trapped in suffering if they can be released. Doesn't mean they can't come back. It doesn't mean that they, right, come back and visit. But I kind of disagree with you a little bit, Andrea. I'm not saying that I'm the one to do it or that you're the one to do it, but there are people out there that do that, and they do it responsibly, and they do it with love. And I don't think for one second that if there is a trapped spirit here at the house, that in them being released, that one, they wouldn't come back, or that it's going to clear out everybody. Because I believe that there are probably spirits here that come and go. And that's
certainly absolutely plausible that they are not necessarily trapped, that they retain free will, that they can come and go as they please, but that they have formed some profound attachment to the house.
Mm-hmm.
The way that I come at this is this was their house first. And I think that they should get to make that decision for themselves. Very respectful. But yes, if I knew that there was a suffering spirit, I absolutely understand your point of view about that. You know, I would not want that to happen to anyone. And in fact, the next time that I am with Cody and Satori, I want to ask them to help me contact April. The one spirit in the house that I perceived to be suffering too, actually, was the little girl and the little boy. And I want to know, with their help through April, if she has made contact with them and how they are. You know, if they are still present in the home, if she somehow took them along with her when she passed away. How that connection has endured in the netherworld, in the afterlife. And so that's job one the next time we're all together.
We'll give it a shot for sure. Okay. At least our opinion on the situation, I'll let Satori again speak for herself. You know, I kind of agree with both of you because you're coming at this from different points of view here. We've come across situations where there are individuals, and I believe this is who you were referring to, Andrea, that clear a home when it doesn't really need to be. Let's say there was a previous owner that is still inhabiting the house, Yeah. And the family just that lives there now just isn't fully understanding the point of view that's going on. There are individuals that their sole practice is to clear any place that they walk into when it's a place that these spirits belong. This is the mm-hmm. house that they built. So they want mm-hmm. to be there. Then on the flip side of things, at least with our experiences, and I'll let Satori tell a story here. We've come across spirits that were just in the wrong spot. They were in the wrong place. And I was there for one of them that we've done.
Yes, we were actually at a house and we had communicated with a woman in the basement and she gave us all this information. And we were like, why are you in the basement? You can come upstairs. The owners had agreed to say, you can come upstairs if you feel more comfortable. And after we had come upstairs, she comes and you hear her footsteps walking around. And we're getting ready to pack up. All of a sudden, you hear footsteps come back up to us, and they say, where's home? And we said, what do you mean, where's home? And she gave us the address, and it was the address of this house. We were like, that's this house. And then she changed the address. He said, no, I'm looking for so-and-so north or so-and-so south. And we were like, oh, that's not this. That's down the street. And as soon as we had told her exactly where to go, we were like, okay, if you feel the energy gravitating towards that way, go that way. And it wasn't necessarily that we were crossing her over, but we were giving her directions because she was confused and lost. Yeah. And she just went about her business and it seemed that we solved it. And it was actually a very funny encounter. Ken was there for it also. So we have encountered lost spirits or spirits that don't really know what they're doing or why they are where they are. And I think it does help sometimes in certain situations to kind of give that nudge or that information. So it's a really interesting thing. We have encountered spirits in the house, the house particularly, Jacqueline, where they have said that they got there. They remember how they got there. It was kind of confusing for them at the time. And it was almost like they thought they were somewhere they shouldn't be, but then they felt comfortable. And they were like, you know, I can come and go. I can come and go as much as I please. I don't really know how I ended up here. I'll tell you what I know, but I love this house a lot. So I'm going to stay here and I'm just going to look over it. So it's really interesting how it works. It's like, do I want to stay lost? Do I want to stay confused because this is more fun than where I was? So it's a hard thing. It's a hard thing. It really is. So we do agree with both.
And, you know, everybody's made, like, the points here. So all I can really do is just put a bow on this. But I think there are spirits, Jacqueline, that are trapped or grounded is another term we use. I think the vast majority, in my experience and in, you know, working with Cody and Satori and documenting what we have over the years, I think the vast majority are of free will. But I think there are spirits that are trapped, but maybe, perhaps, not as many as we think. There are spirits sometimes that are held back by a more powerful entity. Those things happen. Mm-hmm. There are people who are confused. So all of those things happen. I just don't think they happen with the regularity that we believe, because it's a common question an investigator, I've heard them ask going into a place, do you feel trapped here? Do you feel stuck here? Like almost automatically, where we're working from the bottom up rather than the top down and assuming, first of all, that you're here of your own free will. You come in visitation. You know, how are you? Where else can you go? I'm envious of you. You just travel anywhere. And then if you start from that premise, and then you kind of work your way down a little bit, to the point that it's like, you need our help? Because that's something that I don't think a lot of investigators really ask. If we make it a point, it's like, can we help you? Are you in distress in some way? Mm-hmm. Is there some way we can help? I don't know if we can, but we're willing to try. So if you work from that.
I think that's great because I think, you know, otherwise it can be a little exploitative, you know. So I think it's wonderful that you're even asking the question. And I'm sure you're right that there aren't that many. I think I just want to be sensitive. I would never want to exploit, right, a spirit who is suffering and that needs help. I would never want to exploit that.
Yeah.
I think that's my greater point.
you know, I look at the world population, and it's obvious that there are lost souls that are wandering, that can't seem to find their way. And when you think back over the course of history, we've talked about this on the show many times, and I have with you and George as well, Ken. It seems to me, as frowned upon as suicide still is in our society, not considered an act of free will as much as a sin against the Creator. Imagine 200 or 300 years ago how that was looked upon. And so I have to wonder how many spirits are wandering as earthbound souls because they claimed their own lives in an act of desperation. And then they were afraid to go to the light because they didn't know if it was the light.
They would be judged.
Right. Or if it was the fire and brimstone of eternal damnation, which is why, you know,
I think that
ultimately the common denominator is still fear.
No,
they're afraid. Afraid to go on. So yeah. This is more comfortable.
Yeah. No, I don't take issue with that in terms of something that would seem to make sense in a way, depending on their own beliefs. You know, the hesitancy to be judged if they believe that this was the inevitable. You know, a heaven and hell, you know, that transitional period. So, yeah, absolutely. I think that that can go into that category as well.
Right. But
unless you have a trans medium who's outstanding, because, you know, I can't just like turn a camera on and get these answers. Whereas I can get from Cody and Satori and a credible and an excellent medium, you get emotional content. You get something on names and dates. Like you get mindsets. What were you thinking at this time? You know, and those things are incredibly important to discern what situation that spirit is in or was in when they entered into that transition.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah.
And I'm just glad that because we don't really take anything for that stuff. That's not what that's for. I'm just thankful that we can help in any way, both living and dead. And I can tell you, Jacqueline, that the spirits in the house, at least two of them that we have talked to, because they like to talk very much so, they have spoken very highly with excitement that there is, you know, somebody that is positive that's coming into the house. They're keeping a very open mind, and they'd like to tell you their stories at some point. And there are a couple people in the house, and they come through and they want to tell you their stories and how they got there. So I'm sure if you want to hear them
today. That's awesome. I love it. Can you give me a couple of names of who's told you that?
So we have two gentlemen. They're always together. One is named Matthew and one is named Jonathan. Matthew is from the 1800s, and he tells us lots of stories about the house, and him and Jonathan came together to the house, and Jonathan's from 1700s, mm-hmm. and they say they weren't from the house in the history, but they came because they saw a light appear one day, and they came to it, and they said that they saw the parents. They saw a lot of people there. They gave us this whole story. It's a long story.
I can't wait to hear all this story. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, you can hear it all. but they're just there, and they decided, you know, this isn't where we're from, but this is where we want to be because there are people to protect and a house to protect, and they kind of took it on as their own. And they're very, very funny. They have a lot of characters, so I'm sure that they'll warm up to you rather quickly.
We've also talked to an Oliver there who was upstairs.
Yes, we did. And we talked to somebody that claims to be Manny, but his real name is Joseph. And there's people that pass through all the time. It's almost like a community house for spirits. They'll come and go as they please.
It's a lighthouse. Some places are lighthouses.
Yes, very much so. But it's really all interesting.
Yes, we have a lot of things written down that we'll share with you.
Yeah, no, and I can't wait to kind of learn about their experiences, right? As souls that have crossed over, like, so what do you mean you're passing through? Well, like, where are you going next? Like, yeah, what exactly. are you doing, right? I mean, I can't wait to hear these stories and learn what their experience is like on in the other realms. I
would be at Fenway Park at the best seat in the house. That's that's where I'm going.
Well, it's interesting. Oops, sorry.
Oh, I'm so sorry. No, Bill just sent me a message.
Yeah,
and he's got a question that he wants to post. And Bill, you know, if you want, okay, this is from Bill. What about the connection to UFO sightings near the farmhouse? Could it also be similar to Skinwalker Ranch with energy? Has any odd magnetic anomalies been detected? Maybe the house is some sort of portal as well. So that's open for discussion across the board. I think everybody pretty much knows how I feel about this. So, you know, Ken, Cody, Satori, Jacqueline, feel free to pipe in, and I'm just going to listen and get your different perspectives because, you know, I lived it. And so, yeah, I've always described the place as a portal cleverly disguised as a farmhouse. And that's my impression of it. And that's my... my experience with it. So,
yeah, my impression of it, I mean, from what my limited experience so far in stories is that it is kind of like the Skinwalker Ranch of the East Coast.
I think
we're going to discover multiple portals on the property and very different types of experiences, and I believe I agree with you, Andrea, and I believe in the extraterrestrial aspect and visitation of that it attracts extraterrestrials. I believe
don't think it's that easy to discern one from the other. I think that there is a point of correlation and integration that I have yet to determine the true nature of. But it is, and Jennifer in here, you know, Jennifer and Corey have already had those experiences as well. And so it is, it's just a fascinating cornucopia, kind of a hodgepodge lodge of ethereal extraterrestrial activity. Mm-hmm. And if you think about it, spirits are extraterrestrial in that they are no longer earthbound physical vessels.
Yeah.
And they've transmuted and through this transformation, they have attained an entirely different foundation of existence that does not require this physical form and yet still embodies some characteristics of their former physical self. And no one can explain that. No one can explain why we saw a little girl dressed in linen one time and then in her green velvet finery the next time. You know, since when do spirits change clothes?
I know, that's amazing. That is amazing.
You know, there's so many more questions than answers. But when it comes right down to it, and I'll just close with this and then let Ken and Cody and Satori comment. To me, I mean it when I say the answer to every question is love. If you leave that open, if that stays open, then it becomes a conduit like Cody and Satori are for spirit, where they can literally take it in and then impart it in one line of, in its energy, its existence, its consciousness, and in tapping into that unified field of consciousness, I think if answers ever come, that's how they'll come. And I truly, I'll say it again, I believe that Cody and Satori are the future of the paranormal. And I am honored and proud to love them as Auntie Annie, and to watch what they do, where they go, because they have such great character. They're going to take this field afar, way more than any of us old folks like me and Ken. And I think we're born like 6 minutes apart. We did our part. We've put things out there and tried to put the bricks into the foundation, and they're building a castle. All the way into the clouds. I mean, this is a very, very exciting time for this field. And so your timing coming into it as the new owner of the house is absolutely perfect timing. But I will let them address the question as well, because Bill's question is very well founded and absolutely significant to the field.
Yes. If to answer the question, the ground itself holds a lot of energy. And I can tell you, being there, Cody and I, and not to speak for you, but I think we've experienced it. When we go, it's just like a battery refills. There's some weird things that goes on. I can't tell you how many weird things have happened to us in that house, you know, either through our method and just in general. We've seen things, we've experienced things. And yes, we think that the house is some sort of draw. It's some sort of lighthouse, like Ken said, where things just gravitate towards the energy. If it's not the house, it's the land. And we've encountered spirits. I mean, we haven't talked to aliens yet. We're not that lucky. But,
I'll introduce you. It's no problem at all.
But we have encountered spirits that have spoken of such incredible things. They've said, you know, there have been spirits that have interacted with each other. There have been, for example, Jonathan came to us one time and was like, there is a Native American person outside. There are Native people, and we didn't see it. Obviously, it's something that only he saw. It was something only he was encountering. He's like, they're around the house a lot. And
yeah, the Nipmuc tribe, that was their land originally.
Yes. But it's like time is overlapping each other over there. And there's something with the house and the land where there are energies overlapping, and they're all experiencing different times, different experiences. And we're just there for the ride. I can't tell you how many times there have been spirits coming to us going, do you see that too? And we're like, no, we don't see what you're seeing. And so it's like they're experiencing just as much as we are. It's something we don't really understand.
Right. Wow, oh, absolutely. Amazing. I think there are places across the world that definitely hold this energy better than others. And
yes, I agree.
I definitely believe that the Conjuring property, the Harrisville farmhouse, definitely is one of those places. You have the sacred Native American land, you have the geological makeup, and we've found, there's been studies done on this, and I know Ken has looked into this as well, where the geological makeup of different properties has a huge role in the activity that plays. You have places like the Stanley Hotel and Blind Frog Ranch and Skinwalker and all these places that have this strange geological makeup that kind of is like flipping on a switch for paranormal activity. And yeah. To sum it up, bear with me. I think the property is like a head of lettuce, with all of these different layers that you have to unfold. And I don't think we've gotten to the center yet. I think there's still a lot to find out.
Okay. Well, you know, it's a lot more elegant to call it phyllo dough, pulling back one layer at a time. Okay. As a baker, we're going with that metaphor. Okay. That not lettuce.
He's trying. He's trying so hard.
Well, I think for me, I mean, I haven't had, you know, the experiences I've had there where I've been able to document a very terrestrial to this point. So I haven't had that anything as far as, you know, a UFO experience, not there anyway. But Cody pretty much summed up, you know, my questions about the place, and it's geological, because a lot of these places share certain commonalities. I know that I had planned at one point to do a geological study, but it didn't work out. It was some really bad weather. It was last Halloween. I was going to take soil samples. I was going to look into data like tectonic plates in that area, if they're shifting, if there's an energy release, things like that. Just barking up that tree, you know, getting away from the supernatural for a minute and see if all of this factors into the supernatural, cause effect type thing. So I'm still curious and interested in doing something like that to see what the land holds. And if that possibly plays into light phenomena and things like that, and how those type of things can affect us physiologically. Just like moons and everything around us, it affects us physiologically, as does the geological makeup of an area. So it may not be supernatural, but it's, I don't know, it's fascinating to me nonetheless.
Yes, it is. And, you know, what's absolutely stunning to me is that 2 hours have gone by and that we actually have to say good night. This has been truly inspirational episode of the show for me. And I know that it will be seen a multitude of times and that it will touch people at their core. It was a truly uplifting thing. I think that we're living at a time when paranormal activity, supernatural, the existence of the supernatural is more significant than it ever has been. That people are really seeking something beyond their mortal existence. They're seeking truth about an afterlife. I've always said the happiest people I know are obsessed with death, but not really. They're really more obsessed with searching for proof of the existence of an afterlife. I already know there's something beyond our mortal existence. Absolutely. I want many, many other people to have that same sensation and to feel that. And I hope that they gravitate to the farm as if it is magnetized. The immutable law of attraction. Boom. It's in place. This is going to be an extraordinary journey for you, my dear Jacqueline. And I cannot thank you enough. I cannot thank you enough for sharing yourself with our extended paranormal family this evening. I want to thank Cody and Satori. Ken, of course, you are my beloved brother. Those are my kids over there. They're my kids. And I didn't even have to birth either one of them, which was great. And my father just waved goodnight to everyone. So on that note, I thank you all from the bottom of my heart for being here on the broadcast tonight. And I so look forward to the next time that we're all together at the magnificent Richardson Arnold Estate in Harrisville, Rhode Island. And on that note, I thank all of our viewers. Love you all. Bless you all. We'll see you next week on World Awakening. Good night.
Good night.
Mm-hmm.